taking that deep, deep, deep lymphatic breath. Thank you for coming aboard the Friendship Train Ride. Thank you for joining us in making conscious self-health care moves. So let's discover lasting wellness by being our very own wellness doctor. Step up out of the dark ages of disease care. Conscious self-health care moves by becoming your conscious self-health care navigator and leaping into or with the new paradigm of bioenergetics and quantum health care. Yes, advance from the old and embrace the future of now, making conscious self-health care moves by becoming your own wellness doctor. Welcome aboard the Friendship Train Ride, the remedy. We have a pharmacy inside of us that is absolutely exquisite. It makes the right medicine for the precise time, for the right targeted organ, with no side effects. You better believe it, family, community, and friends. I'm your host, Reverend Dr. Karen Khadija Davis, folks, coming to you straight and live from the non-secular science of medicine. Your desire is your prayer. Picture the fulfillment of your desire now and feel its reality, and you will experience the joy of the answered prayer. Family, community, and friends, it's time to take a look from the field vibration of cellular activity. Aboard the Friendship Train, we sit back and take deep, deep, deep lymphatic breaths while we tune into ourselves with the understanding. More and more, we must learn to think not in terms of race or color or language or religion, of political boundaries, but in terms of humanity. Above all races and political boundaries, there is humanity. Welcome aboard the Friendship Train Ride. Thank you for joining us, and we all are making conscious self-health care moves. Right perspective, right results. When your perspective is not clear, your behavior becomes inconsistent. It's time for consistency. Your body will never lie to you. Family, community, and friends, your body will never lie to you. However, your mind will. Step up to quantum health care. Thank you for coming to dance and breathe with me. This Wellness Wednesday on the Conscious Self Health Care Conversation Radio Show. Woo woo! Taking that ride. Woo woo! To healthcare freedom. Woo woo! Making your conscious self healthcare moves. Mental observation view is essential for self success. Greetings, everyone, and thank you for joining me on the Friendship Train Ride today. This is the Conscious Self-Healthcare Conversation Radio Show, and I am your host, Reverend Dr. Karen Khadija Davis, folks, from the non-secular science of medicine. I'm here to assist you with becoming your own wellness doctor. Yes, family, community, and friends, medicine has changed. And you need to change with it by becoming your own wellness doctor. Today, this Wellness Wednesday, 11/2022, we will listen to three talks from Bruce Lipton, Mr. Epigenetics himself, giving you information about the information above gene activity that makes you become your own wellness doctor. we would have more knowledge than most doctors in the world have today. After you listen to these three recordings and incorporate them in your life, because you can be your own wellness doctor. Yes, family, it is time to step up out of the dark ages of disease care. That is why I do not discuss diseases with anyone. You can move above all of those diseases names that they have placed on you in this day and time right now. So take care of your mind every day, learning how to reprogram your brain and mind. I offer you the opportunity to take a new view at your cellular activities and have a free Ness Health Bioenergetics voice scan today from the comfort of your home. One free voice scan and will put you in a new programmable activities for you to be the best wellness doctor that you can today by looking at cellular activities differently than the old school. Yes, family, community, and friends, today shift out of chronic disease care stress right now. You know the saying, fake it till you make it. Speak only good and loving thoughts to yourself about yourself and your conditions that your cells may be in right now displaying to you like I do. So I invite you to visit Conscious, conscious.care.com or the number 4CELLIFE.com and complete the form for your free scan today. You will be able to understand this scan. Then you can shift your energy, shift your thoughts, where you will be able to shift the vibration in your body and support yourself from these low-level cellular diseases that they talk to you about, that they tell you that you have no choice but to use their pharmaceuticals. And that is not the truth, because we know now pharmaceuticals will destroy cellular activity and would not allow the body to heal in the best manner that it can. I will reach out to you once you complete the details on the form from my website. You can give me a call, 202-248-7749, 202-248-0865. And remember, I do not discuss disease care. That's why I'm wanting you to step up to bioenergetics, quantum health care with me, becoming your own wellness doctor, knowing that you can correct cellular malfunctions. Cellular malfunctions brought about by how you've been caring for your physical body and your mental wellness. You may also email me. That's ddavisfoulks@gmail.com. So family, community, and friends, do listen to this show. As you sit back on this train ride, relaxing, massaging your hands, your feet, your head, your ears, getting to a flow, a rhythm of the information, you will have to listen to these recordings more than once while you're creating a new paradigm of thought on how to care for this physical body as well as your mental wellness. More than once to create your thoughts for self-care right now. Right now, family, community, and friends. So I must let you go while I find my seat on this train ride and reinforce what I already know. And that's how I've been taking care of myself through all my cellular malfunctions, including the ones that I am still working with to move and make a difference in my body from the stroke and from the excess fluid and excess sodium in my eye, which says, Karen, this eye, you can't see out of it, but I know I see every day out of this eye, and all this excess fluid will clear as I change the condition of my environment where my cells live at, and you can do the same thing too. So family, community, and friends, sit back on this train ride and step up out of the dark ages of disease care. And yes, it's time to shift out of chronic disease care stress and become your own wellness doctor by understanding and accepting the terms of epigenetics in this day and time, and know that your doctors are truly doing the same thing for themselves. Peace, family.
Are you at your wit's end because there seems to be no solution to your healthcare problem? Is it okay for me to say to you that you can have peace of mind? Take back control of your health. Are you experiencing anxiety, arthritis, diabetes, cancer, fibromyalgia, high blood pressure, lupus, chronic fatigue syndrome, any fictitious disease? Whatever your symptoms or diagnosis are, there is a conscious solution to transform the cause of your pain. Not treat symptoms or mask it. No prescription medication, no over-the-counter drugs, no organs removed are required. Take back control of your health by the renewing of your mind. You can create wellness today. Contact Dr. K, 202-248-7749. Visit us on the web, www.cellife.com.
I will show you the science of actually how the cells work, and you will have more knowledge than most doctors in the world today, because they still believe in the genes. Every cell in your body has a minus voltage on the inside and positive voltage on the outside. Every cell, every live cell, is a battery. Every cell has about 1.4 volts, not too much. 50 trillion cells in the body times 1.4 volts is 700 trillion volts of electricity in your body right now. And with training and meditation, you can focus this energy called chi, and you can use that energy for healing. With that much voltage, people can self-combust. Every function in your body is already present in every cell. So where you have an organ in your body, the cell has an organelle, which means miniature organ. So the textbooks talk about the nucleus is equal to the brain. The nucleus is not the brain. The nucleus is the gonad. The nucleus does not control the cell. The nucleus is reproduction of the parts. So if you are dead and you still have your protein body, what's missing? The signal. So when a signal binds to a protein, what happens to the protein? It moves. It makes behavior. If you are healthy, your behavior is good. But if you have a dis-ease, the behavior is not right. What can cause disease? There's only two things. Either the protein is bad or the signal is bad. People with bad proteins got them from birth defects, because if you were born with defective genes and the genes make the protein, then the protein is defective. But less than 5% of the population has birth defects. That means 95% of the people should have a healthy, happy existence. But if you were one of the healthy people and now you are sick, what would cause the problem? There are only three ways to mess up the signal. One, trauma. So if I fall off the stage and make my wrench my back, the signal is interfered with. Number two, toxins. If the chemistry is not good inside the body, the signal cannot be passed through bad chemicals. Both of these interfere with the propagation of the signal. But the third one is thought, the mind. There is nothing wrong with the body. It's just sending the wrong signal at the wrong time. So if you change your thought and your mind, you can change the biology. And this, the mind, is the primary cause of illness on our planet today. What is the name of the switch that controls your biology? Perception. And why that's important is that it's you and how you see the world that controls the biology. We have been given misinformation. When people say a gene turned on and a gene turned off, it sounds like the genes make decisions. Here is the simple truth. A gene is a blueprint. The gene does no control. The gene is never on or off. The gene is red or not red. And what do you think controls the signal? Perception. You are not the victim of your genes because you control your genes. One gene blueprint, using epigenetic control, can make 30,000 different proteins from one blueprint. So you can come with good genes and then through epigenetic control create cancer, diabetes, and it has nothing to do with the genes but epigenetic control. It returns responsibility for your health to you, and not, you are not a victim of your genes. Yet every day the media still tells you that genes control this and genes control that. And then people get nervous about what genes are in their family. And as Greg Braden said before, if you look for the disease, you can create the disease through epigenetics. Right now, it appears that about 95% of cancer is not because of mutant genes, but because of epigenetic control. And it can be passed from parent to child like genes. But the difference is you can change your epigenetics at any time. If you change your perception, you change the reading of your genes. If someone tells you you're going to have a disease and you believe that, then you can create the disease. So when you look at yourself, you're not a single entity, but you are a community of 50 trillion cells. But it's important to understand the word community. Every cell is intelligent, but when they're in a community, they give up their personal intelligence and respond to the central voice. In that community, that a cell must follow what the central voice is. And if the central voice says to die, the cells will die. The central voice is the mind. There are signals from the environment, the internal and external environment. The brain, the function of the brain is to perceive the signals and then interpret those signals and then send the information to the cells to control the behavior and the genetics. So the function of the brain is perception, and from that creates the mind. Now, we have heard of something called the placebo effect, right? The placebo effect is when you have a very positive thought that something can heal you, even if it's a sugar pill, but you believe it's the real medicine, then you can heal yourself with that. So the pill didn't heal you, it was the thought that healed you. Statistics reveal that one-third of all medical healings, including surgery, are the result of the placebo effect. And this is what medicine does not tell you, is that There is negative thinking, and it's called the nocebo effect. And in the same power that positive thinking can heal you, negative thinking can kill you. Point is that negative thinking can create all the effects of chemotherapy. Now think about this. If a doctor tells you you have a disease, or the doctor tells you you're going to die, and you believe the doctor because he's the professional, the belief will give you a disease and can cause you to die. So belief becomes an important part of medicine. Now, many of you have heard about the drug Prozac. Every year, billions of dollars are spent on buying Prozac. And here's a surprise, that the Prozac is no better than a sugar pill, so that it is a placebo drug. And yet the people who take it believe in the drug so much, it makes them better. So if you believe that something is good for you, it will be good. And if you believe that it's harmful for you, it will be bad. So the question is, if we are so able to be healthy and young, why do we get sick? And one of the most important reasons is stress. And the function of the stress hormones is to take the energy of the body and get it all to run and fight. So the stress hormones will shut off the functions of things that will not be needed in fight or flight. One of the most important uses of energy in the body is the immune system. Stress hormones shut off the immune system. And the significance is every one of you right now is infected with almost all of the disease germs that humans have. Right now, if I take a blood sample, I will show you, you all have viruses and bacteria and parasites. And you might say, well, if I'm infected, then why am I not sick? Because if your immune system is working properly, it will suppress these parasites and germs. But the moment you start to shut off the immune system, then these organisms begin to start growing again. So the idea that you catch a disease is not really true. You already have the disease. And the medical people call these germs and parasites opportunistic organisms. So if you are under stress and you shut off the immune system, then you give these organisms the opportunity to then make the disease. And yet when we get some of these diseases, we go to the medical doctor and they give us drugs to kill the germs and the bacteria. Well, this is very helpful if the disease is going very quickly. That was not the problem in the first place. The problem was stress that shut off the immune system. So to get healing is, okay, treat the disease, but also treat the stress.
Do you feel lost? Do you feel out of sync? Could it be that you are experiencing electromagnetic sensitivity? Yes, electromagnetic sensitivity. Could man-made frequencies interfere with cellular activity and melatonin production? We are beings of frequency, light, and information, and you are your own experience. Do not conform any longer to the patterns of man-made mindset of human consciousness. Be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Schedule your NEST ProVision Human Body Field Scan with Dr. K. 202-248-7749. Visit the website forcellife.com. The number 4CELLLIFE.com. Have the courage to expand your horizon and reprogram your cellular activities. Call Dr. K for your 15-minute wellness consultation. 202-248-7749.
I was teaching in a medical school.
Yeah.
And I was teaching the concept about genes, and everyone, of course, has heard about genes, and they believe that genes control their lives, you know. So running in my family is diabetes, Alzheimer's, cancer, whatever it is, and they say, oh my goodness, I'm a recipient of such genes, and this is going to be my life. And this is a belief of victimization, a victimization of heredity. It's running in my heredity, and I'm going to get these genes, and I can't control it. There's a new biology that switches this whole thing around, because it reveals that genes don't control our lives. It's our perceptions and our response to the environment. It's the environment that influence the genes. Well, the relevance about that is, since we can change our perceptions and we can change our environment, then we're not victims. We're actually masters. But we have to know that. We have to really come from an understanding that we are creating our lives, because if your belief is you're a victim, its belief is translated into biology. You become a victim if that's what you believe.
Yes, sir. So you kind of prove scientifically and biologically that the proof of that, that we in fact are in control of our genes, that our genes aren't controlling our lives. Can you give us a brief sort of bird's eye view of how you prove that, Bruce?
Yeah, it's a wonderful simple experiment. About 47 years ago, I was cloning stem cells. Now, back 47 years ago, there's only a handful of us in the whole world even knew what a stem cell is. A stem cell is an embryonic cell in your body. And the reason why we have all these embryonic cells is because cells have a life and they die. And if we can't replace the cells, then it won't be very long before all our cells die and then we're gone. So a stem cell is a multipotential embryonic cell. Here's the work, simple. I get one stem cell, put it in a dish by itself, and it divides every 10 hours. So first one, and then 2, 4, 8, 16, and the cells keep going. After a week, I've got 50,000 cells in the Petri dish. But here's the most important point. They all came from one parent. So there are 50,000 genetically identical cells. Okay, now here's the experiment.
Yeah.
I take that community and I break them up into three different Petri dishes, and I change the environment a little bit in each dish. Now, cells are like fish. They live in a fluid, so I create like an aquarium with all the things they need to live in it. That's called the environment. And I change the composition of the environment a little bit in each dish. Okay? What happens is, in dish one, I get muscle cells. In dish two, I end up with a different environment, get bone cells. In dish three, yet a different environment, I end up with fat cells. Well, the whole point was this. What controls the fate of the cells? And you say, well, genetics. I go, no, no. They're all genetically the same.
Yes.
So the fate of the cell wasn't determined by the genetics. It was determined by the environment. Okay? And so the information in the environment is really what's involved with selecting our genes. So people say, well, okay, that's really nice. You got cells in a plastic dish. What the heck does that have to do with me? And I go, well, here's the fun part. You look in the mirror. Ty, you look, you see this handsome guy looking back. You say, that's Ty, that's me. And I'm a single human being, a single organism. I go, a slight misperception for this reason. You are not a single entity. You are made out of 50 trillion cells. The cells are the living entity. You, by actual biological definition, you are a community. So you're a community of 50 trillion cells. And so the fun part is, you're a skin-covered Petri dish with 50 trillion cells inside. And you have an environment, a culture medium, and it's called blood. And the chemical composition of the blood determines the fate of the cells. That's what happened in my plastic dish. So to a cell, does it make a difference if it's in the plastic dish or the skin dish? No, it's still going to read the environment. So I say, oh, then the blood is the culture medium, and the composition of the blood controls the genetics. And then I go, yeah, now here's the cool part. I say, but as I showed in the Petri dish, if I change the composition of the culture medium, I change the fate of the cells. So I say, well, who or what controls the chemical composition of my blood? So we go up to the next level. I say, the brain is the chemist. The brain is what releases the chemistry in the blood. And then you go one more step. You say, but what chemicals should the brain release into the blood? And I go, next level up, the mind. What do you perceive? What do you see? What are you looking for? So I say, for a given a person, I say, here we are. I stand here. I open up my eyes and I see someone I love. Well, my mind perceives love and translates that through the brain into chemistry such as dopamine, the pleasure chemical, oxytocin, the bonding chemical, vasopressin, attractiveness, growth hormone, which enhances the growth of the cells. So when a person sees love, experiences love, the brain releases a cocktail of these wonderful chemicals. And think about it. When people are in love, they glow.
Yes.
They're healthy. They have so much energy. I say, well, where'd they get that from? The culture medium. Okay? But I say, look, same person opens their eyes, instead of seeing someone they love, they see someone that, something that scares them. I say, do you release these same chemicals in love? And I go, no, no. When I perceive the world as threatening, or I'm living in fear, I release stress hormones, and I release hormones that control my immune system, inflammatory agents, these things that get me ready for fight or flight. And I go, well, here's the interesting part. As I said, the fate of the cells is based on the chemistry. If I take the chemicals released by the brain in love and put into a plastic dish with cells,
yeah,
the cells grow beautifully. And I say, okay, wait, What about the chemicals that come out of a brain of someone in fear? I take those chemicals, put that in the culture dish, the cells stop growing. Wow. And they get into protection. Protections close yourself down. So the idea is this. When you're in growth, you're open to the world and you say, come on, bring it on.
Yeah.
But when fear or something comes in there, you close it down. And the chemistry of the fear is what shuts down the cells. Fear kills, basically, what it's all about. So basically it says this. We always talk about mind-body, and those strict fundamental scientists go, oh, mind-body, what's that, blah, blah, blah. And I go, it's not a mystery. It's simple. The mind is an interpretation of the world. It causes the brain to release chemistry that matches the interpretation to coordinate 50 trillion cells to live in that world. It's your emotions. It's your perceptions. It's your beliefs. These are the sources of the chemicals that end up controlling the genes. This is a new science. It's called epigenetics. Because epigenetics is a revolution of all of our understanding of science for a very simple reason. When I was a professor in a medical school, we were teaching the concept of genetics. And genetics, most everybody knows, yes, we have genes and the genes control our traits, and that we get the genes from our parents, and so therefore the traits that are running in our family are passed down to us. And sometimes it's a good thing and sometimes it's a bad thing.
Yeah, okay.
You know, you've got diseases running in your family. Last thing you want to know, oh, geez, everybody in my family got cancer. It's like, am I going to be next? Well, I got the genes.
Yeah.
So that's our belief system that we've been teaching, that genes control us. That makes us victims, as I said, because we didn't pick the genes as far as we know. We can't change the genes, so whatever they are, they make us.
Yeah.
And so people walk around going, oh, my life is, you know, not so good. I got these genes. Epi means above. So when I say epigenetic control, I'm literally saying control above the genes. It's the environment that controls it. Well, that includes not just the real environment, but our perception of the environment, because you could live in the healthiest of environments, but if you perceive it to be a threatening world, then it's your cells receive the perception. They don't read the direct world. Genetic control, you're a victim because the genes control you. Epigenetics is a revolution because it says, look, if the environment or my perception controls genes, I'm the one that can change my perception. I'm the one that can change my environment. So all of a sudden, I'm not locked in. I am free to change the way I live in the world, which in turn comes back and changes the genetic readout. And this is really what's so profoundly important. For example, a lot of people talk about the placebo effect.
Yes.
And they say, well, what's the placebo effect? Well, this pill is going to cure you. It's the greatest new science in the world. And I believe that. And I take the pill and I get better. And then they tell me it was just a sugar pill. So then the truth is, well, what healed me? Well, it wasn't the sugar pill. It was the belief in the pill. So everyone says, oh, yeah, placebo effect. That's how you have this wonderful thought and you get better. And I say, yeah. But here's the problem. We've only talked about the placebo effect. There's another thing called the nocebo effect. The nocebo effect is, what is the consequence of a negative thought? And it turns out, it's equally powerful in controlling your biology and your genetics as is a powerful, as a placebo, positive thought.
Yeah.
So we talk about, oh yeah, placebo, good thoughts create good health and good life. And then I say, yeah, and a bad thought, a negative thought, a nocebo effect can actually kill you. It can cause a disease. If you believe you're going to get this cancer because everyone says you're going to get this cancer, and then your perception is sending cancer thoughts into your body, the chemistry that comes from the thoughts to the brain to the body is a chemistry that doesn't support health, but it'll actually lead to your own death. So all of a sudden, it's the power of your perceptions, positive or negative, that override your genetics. Well, this is most amazing because all of a sudden you look around and you say, but look at all those wonderful, happy people. And look, they're not only just happy, they're also healthy.
Yes.
And the fact is, yes, they're sending in a chemistry that the cells will really thrive with. In this world, it is true that people want immediate action. That's the world we live in, immediate gratification. So if I'm sick, I want something immediately to handle the issue. And of course, we look to the world of drugs for this understanding. But the problem with this is that there are more effective ways of healing. Now, the problem with the energy healing is that it really involves consciousness, mind, and our ability to change our belief systems. Well, this takes a little bit more work than popping a pill. And in fact, I'll just get my own particular case. I remember years ago when I was getting off on this out of my conventional medical academic background and coming into this world, and I faced a stressful situation where I got pneumonia. And I started to realize at some point, it's like, okay, I'm going to sit here and
grab a hold of this with my conscience and my spirit and get my immune system all pumped up and work on this. And I started to realize that the bacteria were dividing faster than my ability to control the bacteria. And so it came a realistic moment. It said, yes, I know I can possibly control this, but the effort that it's going to take is going to take a little bit more time than the drug. So I actually went and bought the penicillin. And the significance is when you need it at that moment. But the issue is, had I not been stressed, had I taken care of my health a little bit better, I would not have come to that precipice where I was forced into taking the drugs. And so the reality is that in switching from a drug-based reality into an energy, medicine, spirit-based reality, we have to go through a learning curve and learn how to take control of our thoughts, our mind, and control the biology that we were given. When we do that, then it's far better than the drug world for a very simple reason. There are no side effects. And so basically, it says that if you start healing with spirit and energy, that you get an unencumbered healing process as compared to dealing with drugs and then dealing with the myriad side effects that are listed on all the packages. So it says both work, but one is far superior to the other. And yet I wouldn't throw out the medication because when it's necessary, it's necessary. But it's just a little warning to you when your symptoms start going up. It says pay attention to the symptoms because the symptoms are really informing you that you're not living in harmony or in health and that the body is telling you this. And so rather than shutting off the symptoms with a drug, it's really important for us to take on a learning role and say, I am creating this situation and I can uncreate this situation without the use of drugs.
If you want some amazing affirmations with Dr. Joe Dispenza, check it out right there next to me. I think you'll enjoy it. Continue to believe and I'll see you there.
When I'm going through change in my life or I have a specific outcome that I want to create, I love to get up early in the morning. That's my time. I'm a 4:30 in the morning guy because that's my time.
Is it time for a new approach to your health care? Are you ready to leave the dark ages of disease care management and pharmaceuticals? If your answer is yes, get ready to relearn, rethink, and rewrite your personal health care prescription plan with Dr. K. She is a certified lymphologist and Nest health care provider, sharing the new science of information as medicine and cellular ecology. Did you know that the field of epigenetics states that you are more than just your genes, and those genes do not control your biology? Yes, that's correct. Schedule a Skype, phone, or office visit with Dr. K and get on board the friendship train to healthcare freedom. 202-248-7749. That's 202-248-7749. Visit us on the web. ForSaleLife.com. The number four, the word sale, CELLLIFE.com.
95% of our life is coming from the programs of how to live life that we get in the first 7 years of life. And that's why poor people stay poor and rich people stay rich. The movie The Matrix is not science fiction. It's a documentary. Every human, and it's a fact, every human first 7 years is downloaded to hypnosis. The brain of a child under seven is in a lower vibrational frequency. When you put wires on a person's head, you read electroencephalograph, reading brain activity. A child below seven has a lower vibration than consciousness. It's called theta. Theta is imagination. Oh, that's how kids play a tea party with mud pies. But to them, it's a real thing. A kid rides a broom. It's a horse. That's theta, imagination. Theta is also hypnosis. And the idea is this, before you can become conscious, if you don't have any programs, what are you going to be conscious of? So nature makes the first 7 years. What kind of programs are required to live on this planet? I say, how do you get them? Theta is hypnosis. You just watch. You watch your parents, you watch your siblings and your community because you have to learn how many 100,000 rules. Think about it. Just to be a functional member of a family and a functional member of a community, there are rules. Teach an infant these rules. You don't have to. First 7 years, I just did observe it and just download it. And then I say, why is it relevant? Because this is the unfortunate fact. 95% of our life comes from those programs in the subconscious. Every day, only about 5% of their life are you using conscious, which is creative. 5%. And you don't see it because it's called subconscious, below conscious. And the Jesuits, for 400 years, they were boasting. People didn't understand. They say, give me a child until it's seven and I will show you the man. They've been saying that for 400 years because they knew 7 years was the program period. And 95% of your life after that will be whatever that program is. A child isn't functioning in consciousness until after seven. Before seven is direct record. Whatever you just said, I just recorded it. So if the parent gets mad at the child and says, you don't deserve that, you don't deserve this, go. The child is not consciously understanding what you mean. Child, just record it. I do not deserve. Now, if I hear that several times, especially in an emotional situation, because that downloads it faster, and now I'm 40, 50 years old, what is my behavior 95% of the time? And the answer is, well, it comes from the program. I do not deserve. Well, that means unconsciously I will sabotage myself to make sure that the program is correct. I'm making the program true by adjusting the behavior to meet the program. Look, this is not new. I mean, there's a famous book, Rich Dad, Poor Dad. And basically said, you come from a poor family and you could struggle your whole life and try to get rich, but you're not going to make it. And if you come from a rich family, you could be stupid your whole life and make it. Not because it was thinking, but it was unconscious behavior that was downloaded from rich families into kids, which is unconscious. So they're making the right moves unconsciously. If they engage their conscious mind, then they look stupid, but it's unconscious. And that's the same thing with poor people. Poor people have beliefs from the family. Oh, you can't make it. Life's a struggle. Things are hard. Who do you think you are? And if that's the program you get, then 95% of the day, you will sabotage yourself. And that's why poor people stay poor and rich people stay rich, because of the programming. Before I put this knowledge into effect, and I use the word put into effect, why? I had the knowledge academically. It's like, oh my God, look at the research. What does it mean? I understood it from the level. And with all that knowledge, it didn't change my life. People read self-help books. I go, well, you read the book. You got a lot of knowledge. I say, is your life changed? No, but you got a lot of knowledge. And so here's the difference. The conscious mind is creative and can learn in any number of ways. Read a self-help book, go to a lecture, listen to this, and conscious mind's going to get some awareness. And I go, yeah, but subconscious mind doesn't learn that way. Subconscious mind learns in two fundamental ways naturally. Hypnosis, which is the first 7 years. And after age seven, how do you put new programs in? Repetition. Practice. You want to drive a car? You didn't learn how by just getting in the seat and put the key in. You had to practice driving the car. You want to learn the alphabet. How many times did you go from A to Z? Try to go to A to Z before you can complete it. And once you completed it, you didn't have to go back and do it again. So two phases. You want to train the subconscious mind? Hypnosis, repetition. I like the last one because there's a new phrase that's bandied about called fake it till you make it. Meaning, if you're not a happy person, I say you want to be a happy person, then repeat all the time. I'm happy. I'm happy. I say, well, you don't look happy or anything. You say, no, who am I talking to? By repetition, I'm talking to subconscious. If subconscious gets, I am happy, and 95% of your life comes from that subconscious, there will be a point once the subconscious got, I am happy, you don't have to say it again. It'll be automatic. It's repetitive. That's the secret part. Putting a sticky note on the refrigerator is more like a suggestion, but it's not a repetition. So it doesn't work very well. Repetition is a habit. It's making habit. So you got to do something religiously in the sense of repeating it, repeating it, repeating it to make it work. Every night when you go to bed, just when you're falling off into sleep, consciousness is disconnecting. The next period of your brain operation while your consciousness is disconnected is theta, which is the same brain function as in the first 7 years. So if you put a pair of earphones on at night with a program of what you would like to be true in your life, as soon as your conscious mind disconnects, that program is playing. It's not playing into your conscious mind. That's shut off. It's now going straight into the subconscious mind. So it's called auto-hypnosis. You don't need to go see a hypnotherapist. You just have to pick out what program would you like to have that you don't have. 95% of your life is coming from the subconscious. Your life is a printout of your subconscious behavior. Oh, so you don't have to try and think about what happened. I just say, look at your life. The things you like that come into your life come in because you have a program that supports them. But anything you struggle with, work hard at, put a lot of effort into making it happen, why you're working so hard, inevitably you have a program that doesn't support that conclusion and you're trying to override the program. So you don't need to do a lot of shrink and psychology stuff. You just look at your life and say, where am I struggling? Because wherever you're struggling, inevitably it's a program in your subconscious that does not support that destination you've been looking for. I had to deal with the issue of teaching medical students and going into the classroom teaching conventional curriculum is the old genes control life story. And so I go in there and teach that to medical students. But when I'd go back in my lab and look at my research on stem cells, my research revealed conclusively that the environment in which the cells live determined genetic activity. So it's complete opposite of what I was teaching in medical school. And the difference is profound. The conventional story, almost everybody's programmed with genes turn on and off, and then they control the character of your life. And if you buy that story, which I did and which I was teaching, it really means that we're victims, victims of our heredity. We didn't pick the genes as far as we know. You don't like the traits, you can't change the genes, and the genes appear to turn on and off by themselves. All of a sudden, you see, your life is not under your control, it's under the control of the genes. And a lot of people feel that way, looking at their family history and going, oh my goodness, I might have the genes for cancer or whatever it is. Since consciousness is involved, if once I feed you with an idea that you are susceptible to something, look, I can feed you with an idea that this pill that we just got from the pharmaceutical company, it's the greatest, best thing for your issue. And I give you this pill and you get better. And then later you find out it was a sugar pill and everybody goes, yeah, that's called the placebo effect. And I go, what does it really mean? You didn't get healed by the pill. You got healed by the belief in the pill. Well, yeah, that's what placebo is all about. And at least one third, minimum of one third of all medical intervention is it's a placebo effect, that where the healing comes from. Everybody goes, yeah, I know about the placebo. I go, yeah, but that's a result of positive thinking. What about negative thinking? And this is what we don't talk about, but the reality is it's equally powerful in regard to affecting your biology as is positive thinking, but it works in the opposite direction. A negative thought is called the nocebo effect. It can cause any disease and you can die. If you believe you're going to die, you can die from the belief. Here's a simple fact. Stress causes at least up to 90% of doctor visits. How can stress do this? And the answer is very simple. Stress causes a hormone called cortisol to be released in the body. So what does cortisol do? Number one, it causes the blood in the viscera, the guts, where maintenance of the body and healing comes from, all the organs. It causes the blood vessels to shut down because it pushes the blood to the arms and legs. Why? Stress means you're ready to run, fight or flight. So you push the energy to where you need it, arms and legs. Well, where do you get it from? Well, you squeeze the blood vessels in the gut. Well, this is growth. The viscera is growth. That's what the organs are for. Arms and legs are for protection. If I'm in protection, I shut off growth. And more importantly, stress hormones shut off the immune system. The reason is just energy. The idea is if you're being chased by a saber-toothed tiger and you have a bacterial infection, how do you want to split the energy? How much energy do you want to run away and how much you want to fight the immune, you know, with the immune system? The answer is the hell with the bacterium. I mean, if the tiger catches you, the bacteria is useless. That's meaningless, you know? So when you're in stress, stress hormones shut down the immune system to conserve energy. Does the immune system use energy? Of course. If you've ever been really sick, you never even got out of bed, you have no energy. And if you're in fight or flight mode, you need the energy to deal with the world. So stress hormones physically shut off the immune system. When you're under stress, that's when sickness starts to show up. In fact, it's so good at shutting off the immune system, doctors give patients who are going to receive a foreign organ, a graft of a kidney or a lung or whatever they're grafting, that's foreign tissue. If you put a foreign organ in your body, your immune system's job is to eliminate it. So as they're transplanting an organ, they give the patient stress hormones at the same time, because stress hormones will shut off the immune system so the organ won't be rejected right away. That's how effective it is. It's used therapeutically to shut off the immune system. Yeah, but everybody out there in this world right now, with a small exception, is under some level of stress. Every one of those people is dripping stress hormones continuously in their body, and those hormones inhibit the immune system. And the result is illness. And if you stop the growth, you say, yeah, but I'm an adult, I don't need to grow. And I say, yeah, but you have to replace hundreds of billions of cells that you lose every day. So we really have to watch out, because as psychologists would tell us, 70% or more of our thoughts are negative and redundant, replaying the same negative thoughts. I go, if thoughts had nothing to do with it, fine. But thoughts, positive or negative, shape our biology. And all of a sudden it says, well, now it's time to wake up, because our negative thinking is manifesting a negative life experience. But it's not just me saying this. It was me saying this when I first started doing this work in 1970. And my research was repeatable every day. I could take stem cells are embryonic cells, so they have no potential until you put them in an environment. And then depending on the culture medium, by the chemistry of the culture medium, I can make the cell become a muscle cell, change the culture medium, make the same cell become a bone cell, or change it again and make the same cell become a fat cell. And genetically, the cell is the same. It was the environment that I was changing. And I started talking about that long before the new science called epigenetics. had come into vogue, which was 1990. So I was like 20 years ahead. And of course, for much of that time, my colleagues looked at me like I was a crazy guy because everybody knew the conventional dogma. And I was, coming up with a whole different line of belief about it. And now it's come into mainstream. The only problem is this. When you invest so much money into a belief system, and then a belief system isn't really right, you try to hold on as long as you can, because if you spend hundreds of billions of dollars in this belief, you don't want to just go, oh, okay, we'll just change it. So it's a struggle, but the reality is coming forward, and the public is just becoming aware of it, and it's a revolution, because if you believe genes control your life, you're a victim of your heredity. When I say epigenetic control, almost sounds the same, but epi means above. So when I say epigenetic control, literally it's control above the genes. And this is what we now recognize, that the environment, and very specifically our perception of the environment, changes our genetic activity. So that means, well, wait, that's not a victim, because I can change my environment, I can change my perception, and all of a sudden, if I can do that, then I can control my genes. Well, we're going from victim to mastery, from genetics to epigenetics.
Greetings, everyone. Are you still taking care of your human body field cellular malfunctions from an outdated healthcare system? Why not shift out of chronic disease care, stress, pharmaceuticals, vaccines, and surgery, and step up to energetics, epigenetics, and quantum health and healing with me? Step up and take control of your health journey. I offer you one free human body field voice scan from your computer or phone. Instant access to your scan results and more free quantum health information. For more details, visit ConsciousSelfCare.com. ConsciousSelfCare.com. Or call Karen Khadijah Davis Folks, 202-248-7749. Yes, it's time to be your own wellness doctor.
That was a great show. I want to thank you so very much for tuning in to the Conscious Self Healthcare Conversation Radio Show right here on Inner Light Radio. It was a pleasure having you tuning in. Now, you must tell a friend to tune in. And if you haven't called in and shared your wellness story, don't you think it's time that you help somebody with your wellness story? Call in, share your story, join the conversation. I'm Karen Khadijah Davis, folks, and I invite you to visit my website, ConsciousSelfCare.com. Or you can just go to the number 4, the word CELLLIFE.com. Leave me some information. I would love to talk with you. And once again, I look forward to you joining us next Wednesday right here on the Conscious Self Healthcare Radio Show. It's a conversation where we uplift each other, where we share our wellness stories so we can help someone move from disease care to conscious self health care. Thank you for tuning in. I look forward to hearing from you next Wednesday.